Hi folks, so today I thought we'd have a look at the formation of a tropical storm and the conditions that are needed and its sort of life stages. So I've summarised it down into six boxes, beginning here and ending here, where it reaches land, and I'm going to annotate these and talk you through the different stages so that hopefully you'll be able to answer exam question which asks you about tropical storm or hurricane formation. So to begin with, please excuse my rudimentary earth, but this is the earth and the dots are the equator. They basically happen, tropical storms, the clue's in the name, between the tropics. And that's because the ocean temperature, the sea temperature in that area is at least 27 degrees or sometimes higher. It needs to be at least 27 degrees for a tropical storm to form. So that's between the tropics. With climate change, we are starting to see the intensity of tropical storms grow and also the frequency and also where they are. So they're starting to sneak out a bit further from the tropics with climate change. Now what happens when the sea is that warm is that warm air moves upwards, warm things rise. So basically the warm air rises up and it draws up water vapour with it. So if we just put that there, so warm air from just above the surface of the sea, so it's quite moisture rich, moves upwards. And in that process, it is drawing up water vapour. So that's water that's in air form, air that's very full of water, but it's invisible, can't see it. Now in stage two, what happens because of that warm air, I'm actually just going to write that in big letters there. So it's rising up. Because it's rising up, it's creating an area of low pressure. Now, low pressure has been created because that air is rising. So what happens is that low pressure has a rising air, and it actually creates what we call sort of cumulonimbus clouds. So if you want to just draw some nice big clouds there, and if we label them cumulonimbus, these are those really big kind of white puffy clouds, sort of storm clouds that you sometimes see before it actually started raining. And that's because the evaporated air, the air that was moving up, has actually cooled down and condensated. So there's a big process of condensation going on here. And we'll just explain that over here. So that's evaporated air. Remember, it's full of water vapour. It cools down, condenses to form thunderclouds, which, remember, if you want the proper term, are cumulonimbus clouds. Now we've got our big, big storm clouds brewing. We've still got that warm air, warm, moisture-rich air rising up. And then we're going to draw another big, even bigger, let's have an even bigger cloud, big thunderclouds. And now we've got heat happening because we've still got condensation occurring, but we've got condensation happening on a much bigger scale. Remember, this is where water vapour that's in there actually cools down and turns into clouds. And what we need to say about that is that the process of condensation, so one particle's turning into other particles, actually releases heat. I'm going to put that in capital letters. So you've got the warmth of the water, and now you've got heat being released in the process of condensation. And what that does is that actually powers up the storm. So now the storm's getting fuel from the water and fuel from the process. Now if we move on to stage four, we're looking at what actually happens here. So again, we've got our big thundercloud. I'm not going to draw it quite so big because there's a few other things I need to draw in there. So remember, we've still got condensation happening, and with that, heat being released. And we've still got this low pressure. And now that we've got such a big low pressure system going on here, just draw these arrows, we've actually got air moving in. And it's moving into that low pressure area. Because Earth likes things in balance. If things are out of balance, something else will try and come in and take the space. So where there's low pressure there, air is sort of being sucked in to fill the void in a way. So air is moving into the low pressure area. Okay, but also it's spinning. Now it's spinning due to the Coriolis effect, and it spins differently depending on what hemisphere you're in. So if I just draw one swirl going one way, let's imagine we're looking down on the system, and then one going the other way. Okay, now the one that's going anti-clockwise is in the northern hemisphere. So we'll just write northern hemisphere at the top. And then the one that's going clockwise is in the southern hemisphere. And actually, we could draw that up here as well. So just put a little one there, and then a little clockwise one there. And that one's going clockwise. Okay, and then if we move on to stage five, now the storm is really growing. It's spinning, it's got a huge amount of condensation and some really big storm clouds. I'm just gonna draw them smaller here because I wanna illustrate something else to you. So I'm just drawing in some rain bands, rain walls. Is that known? So this is sort of the structure of the cloud or the storm. And these storms are really significant in size. So they can reach, well, much bigger than this, but let's go for 100 kilometers, just on average. So big, big hurricane we've got now. And we've got some movement of air as well. So we've got air moving over and around and then down, remember filling that low pressure system, and then we've also got air sinking and actually cool air coming in like this. So we've got this warm, remember, big lot of air going up, and this is warm air, it's full of water vapor from the sea, and we've got all that heat in the storm. That's going out and around the storm, cooling down, falling back down, and then coming back in to fill that gap. And that's happening on both sides of the storm. And then in here, we've actually got cold air sinking down into the eye of the storm. And we'll talk a bit more about the eye in a second. So what we need to write down, we need to say that firstly, that condensation, which is that process, remember, where evaporated air is cooling down. So condensation fuels the storm. Okay, making even bigger clouds. And then that's number one. Number two, we talked about the Coriolis effect that causes it to spin. That's the earth spinning. So the Coriolis, might do that in science as well. The Coriolis effect causes the clouds to spin around the eye wall or around the eye. You've got the iris in the centre, and the area just around the eye is known as the eye wall. Now, the eye wall is nothing like the eye. It's the fastest, it's got the fastest winds, the heaviest rain. It's the most intense part of the storm. But actually, in the eye itself, it's very calm. So we need to say the eye wall is the heaviest rain and fastest wind speeds. That's where they're recorded. And then number four is the eye itself is calm. And remember, on a storm this big, the eye might stretch for 1 or 2 miles wide. So as the storm does sort of pass over you, you'll notice that, you know, almost everything improves for a few minutes, maybe longer, maybe 10 minutes, maybe more. And then the full force of the storm kicks back in. Now, without going into more detail on that, let's talk about what happens once the hurricane reaches land. Now, imagining this hurricane is moving along the ocean and then it's getting towards land, two things happen. One, its energy supply goes. So no more lovely, warm, moist air full of water vapour. And the other thing is friction with the land. Now the land, you know, it's got houses on it, it's got tarmac. There is an element of friction, okay, on the land. So what actually happens is that sort of naturally slows it down. So let's put that up here. Once the hurricane reaches land, the energy, remember its energy is the condensation, the heat from the condensation, the warm air from the sea, the energy supply is cut off. So basically, I'll put a big RIP, the storm will die. It won't immediately disappear. It's not like a tornado that's there 1 minute and gone the next. It will just become a regular storm, a regular sort of normal storm, a storm like we might experience with, say, 60, 70 mile an hour winds, but it won't be a hurricane anymore. And the second thing that I just mentioned is that friction with the land slows it down. And that's good because it's sort of no longer then a threat. So it quickly dies out. Unless it's like Hurricane Katrina or other hurricanes that we've studied, where they do actually sort of dabble a bit. They kind of come onto land and then pick up, sort of change direction, pick up another warm water supply, and then they can take off again. So it really is important that they run out of energy, that they get away from the water. I hope that's helpful in understanding the formation of a tropical storm.